I would like to first acknowledge the tragic loss that we've suffered as a discipline and as a community by the passing of Maria Lugones. And I think that her influence outside of the field will continue to bring, in and outside of the field, will continue to bring clarity to the complexity of our intermeshed experiences. But more importantly, I think a small part of Lugones will continue to live through us as we continue to learn how to playfully and lovingly travel to other worlds. And here, I would just like to, before we really get into the questions and her theory, I'd like to give you a second to maybe think about some of the good memories that you've had with Maria, or some of your first interactions with her, or just memories, or how you would like to personally describe her.
Well, first of all, thank you for the interview and for letting me explain how Maria's work has been so important for me. In fact, I would say that reading her work, I first read the World Traveling essay, as many people start with that essay, in probably 1996. I was a new assistant professor who was recognizing that I really didn't have a community, a philosophical community. And I read her essay and it changed my thinking, my world, my philosophical world, and actually my personal world. And then I met her in a Society for Women in Philosophy, Women of Color group that she used to run. And I had never been in a meeting of that society. And so I went actually so I could be part of that discussion in that group, because I had heard that she had, within the society, she had this group. And so I went, and I remember she presented a super interesting work that has not been published. There are parts of it that are her ideas on active subjectivity, actually, were already there. And this was an essay called Long and Wide Selves. And what I remember when seeing her the first time was that here is this powerful, powerful woman and brilliant woman. And I also immediately could get the sense that her thought, as she herself puts it in her book, was against the grain. I have always been fascinated by theories of selfhood and identity. And what she was talking about was a rethinking of the self that already had this idea that she will develop later in the street walking theorizing essay of active subjectivity. And I was profoundly moved by her energy, her strength. And to be truthful, I was always, I was also a little bit scared, because she seemed tough, and she seemed that she would be very forward with her answering questions. And so I noticed that there was a great deal of respect for her, and I could see both admiration and fear in the group. And I think it was clear to me that I was meeting somebody who was a very special person and a very special thinker. Once I read the World Traveling essay, I just started reading everything that she was writing or that she had written. And I invited her to an early meeting of the what used to be called the Roundtable on Latina Feminism. And now it's Latina X Feminisms Roundtable. And she stayed in my house. And at first I was a little bit nervous about having this incredibly smart woman and powerful woman not just in terms because she was already known and people really admire her, but because she seemed tough and strong. But what I found out in that stay, when she stayed over in my house, that she had this very interesting side to her that I wasn't sure actually if a lot of people had seen it. And it was this tenderness. We started talking in my kitchen, and we just started talking about life, the things that she liked, art, because I love art, and she also really liked art. A dog that I had at the time, his name was Mundo, and Mundo came in, and she started playing with Mundo, feeding him. And I have to tell you, I don't know if it's because I myself love animals, deeply love animals, that I was so moved by her interaction with Mundo and the way she fed him and the way she smiled and laughed when interacting with Mundo. And there I discovered that Maria had multiple sides to her. Right, just as her account of selfhood allows for this understanding of multiplicity, complexity, and even contradiction, that Maria herself was like that and showed different parts of her in different contexts. And so I will always remember actually that aspect of her. Because I thought that that was an aspect of her that you could not see always when she was presenting or when she was answering questions.
It's funny because I often really feel like I'm reading about myself. There's things that she says where I'm kind of looking over my shoulder because there's this precision to which she talks about certain experiences or certain uncertainties that we experience when we're trying to navigate certain spaces or certain environments. And I think there's a really artful way in which she describes dwelling in between worlds of sense, and she carefully articulates many of the confusing experiences I've encountered in my life as a Chicana. I wanted to ask you what some of the ways that you also found yourself living some of the things that Lugones describes in her work.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I have to say that when I read her work, when I read the world traveling essay, I also thought that she was talking about, I think a lot of us that live, that have bicultural experiences or that lived in between worlds and that are part of multiple worlds, feel this when we read her. And that's precisely how she it grabs us and why it's such a strong connection to her work. I think she does an incredible job describing the lived experience of people like us that inhabit various positionalities and sometimes are in between. And I think she captures very well this idea of the possible and actual contradictions that happen when we are inhabiting in-betweenness, liminality, or borderlands, whichever way people describe that way of being in the world. Having spent a lot of time with her words, and her thinking, I find that there are so many notions of her work that I find myself thinking about continuously and also engaging with them in my own lived experience. And I think that one of the most important notions that comes out of her work is this idea of complex communication. And I think this is something that all of us, whom I call multiplicitous selves, that we are selves occupying multiple locations, we have to learn about complex communication, and meaning that there is no transparency between individuals. When you are in a room, and suppose that you're in a room with a number of Chicana, Chicanx people, you cannot assume transparency, meaning you cannot assume that you completely understand them and that you relate to them or that you can relate to each other in the same way. What Maria teaches us that is that even when we are in the limen, when we are in the margins and we are in difficult spaces, we have gotten to the limen, to the margins, to these difficult spaces in many different ways. We have traveled to these spaces or find ourselves in these spaces for many different reasons. And so it is not possible for us to think that we will completely understand each other and know each other as we meet. And I think that's an incredible thing that I find myself constantly experiencing in my life and thinking about it and being reminded of, right? That even with members of my own group, I have to do a lot of work, right? In order to understand them, because there might be some translation that I might need or some things that will not get translated in terms of our experiences. And I think part of the reason is that also has to do with her idea that, and I think this is something that she reads in Chicana writing, especially in Gloria Saldúa, that we find ourselves as, I'm somebody who is oppressed, but also resisting. And so in my lived experience, when I am navigating the different spaces and worlds that I have to navigate, just like anybody else, like you have to navigate all these different worlds, right? That you find yourself that in some of those worlds, people are very demeaning and condescending, or they don't expect you to be smart or to have something to say. And in that sense, you're being oppressed. And yet, if you think of ourselves as Latinx, Latinas, we can also think of the many, many, many Latinas and Latinx people that are living in circumstances of poverty, in deep oppression, in homelessness, doing jobs that are terrible or being treated horribly in their jobs. And so in a sense, we are part of some of the structures that oppress them. And insofar as we take part, right, we have the responsibility to admit that in that sense, we are oppressing ourselves. When we partake of institutions that themselves oppress our groups. And yet we are also resisting. As she puts it, Maria is very interested in the notion of resistance, but for her, she likes to use the gerund resisting instead of the idea of resistance, right? She's thinking of resisting. So we find ourselves resisting in various context. And so that's another idea that I think has been very much part of my living with her theory. There are many others. I don't know how much time we have, but I certainly wanted to point those two out because I think they're super important. And just very quickly, this idea of that she herself she chooses to title her work peregrinajes, pilgrimages, right? And this idea that for her, she was attracted to this notion, this practice, because it basically is a practice which disrupts normalized spaces where you with your body, moving yourself along different paths, you're creating new ways of doing things. And it's also a sustained activity. As she always says, resisting continues. And so I like this idea of walking, even, right, thinking of the traditional way of a peregrinaje or going towards a place. In her sense, it is an activity that continues as we continue to have to resist oppressive norms or structures in our society.
She really firmly pushes against the theories of oppression that leave the subject without any alternative or like any trajectories for escape.
Yes.
And so because of that, she's really committed to providing an account for the different ways in which I think that oppressed individuals still maintain their agency even while being oppressed. And so that is an account for the ways in which, I mean, the many ways in which I think oppressed individuals actively resist their subjugation in the spaces or the moments that they can.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to ask you about how strong of an influence these contributions that Lugones has made have had on decolonial and feminist thought in general.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think that's a great question. I think it's a difficult question. The question of agency in Maria's work is a difficult one because the notion of agency ends up being too connected. So you have this notion of agency. Well, who has agency? It's a subject that has agency. And who's the subject? It's an I. And who is this I? Maria, I think one of the reasons why her work is so important is that she recognized that this I, she was distrustful of this idea of the I that gets to be the subject and gets to be the subject that acts or has agency. And so in her work from the beginning, in the world traveling essay, she's already dismantling this idea of this I. If we think of the I, which usually it's in the tradition, has been seen as this unified self, this unified being. And so from the beginning, Maria is already rethinking that idea that to be an agent, you have to be this unified self. And instead, she has this account of world traveling in which in her account, you get to be a different selves in different worlds. So this I is not this fixed I, right? And then in her work, it continues to shift to the point where in the essay on street walking theorizing, she develops an account of what she calls an active subject. And what she's proposing is an attenuated sense of self. And ultimately, she gives up on the idea of agency and supplants the idea of agency with active subjectivity. So those who are marginalized, those who are oppressed, are not an I, but the way she puts it is also you have to visualize it. She writes on the page, I, arrow, we, right? And so this is signifying that the self is no longer just the I alone, but it's an eye that's looking for company. and an eye that's looking for company in many ways, including how to resist oppressive structures, oppressive norms, oppressive practices, how to move against the grain. Given this account that starts from the questioning of the I to a positing of this active subjectivity, an active subject that is always located in space, because in the end, her theory ends up being a spatial politics. You're always with other negotiating spaces and meanings with each other, disagreeing, agreeing, trying to figure things out, creating strategies. Given this account of active subjectivity, her work then becomes deeply, deeply important for feminism. Because as we know, and as she wrote beautifully about, she had many critiques against feminism as radical as feminism was. White feminists end up assuming not only universal sisterhood, but also end up effectively undermining or not recognizing the work by scholars of color. And so, despite the fact that feminists are making some very important move, resistant moves, they are also, in a way, undermining some of their own very practices of freedom. And so, having this sense that you always, that you're always resisting, that there has to be an active subject at work, stands to problematize even very radical and resistant feminist practices. In fact, that view really puts in question a number of feminist theorists that are also incredibly committed to a notion of agency that ends up being too connected to traditional accounts of agency. And so in that sense, her work, I think, is incredibly important. And of course, if we think about her later work, because I see these two moments, well, I would say that there are three moments in her work. But the later work in which she reads decolonial, Latin American decolonial theory, she reads Quijano, Mignolo, Dussel, and she replies to Quijano, and she points out that they have not done enough work in terms of gender. And even though she's looking at the way that Quijano importantly discusses the issue of race in the coloniality of power, she importantly shows that we cannot separate race and gender, right? That when we're talking about those about race, we have to include gender. And she develops this important account of the coloniality of gender. And that account has, as many people who are keeping up with her work know, has been highly influential in feminist circles and people who are interested in the colonial feminism. And of course, she has an essay also on prompting us to move towards decolonial feminism. I do want to add that the move towards decolonial feminism has been with us for a while. If we think about even if we think recently, we can think of Chicana feminists such as Chela Sandoval and Emma Perez, and including Gloria Anzaldúa, whose work is decolonial. And I think that it's very important for us to take part, to engage with that genealogy in terms of decolonial feminism, because as important as Maria's work is in the development of a critique of Latin American decolonial theory and as in the development of decolonial feminism in the US, we have to be careful to add the decolonial work that has been taking place already in US academia and also in various parts of Latin America, work that's being written in Spanish, for example, by Yuderkis Espinosa. I think that we need to be mindful of that. So her work, I think, is key on issues of the coloniality, but I think it would be important for us to think of that work also in connection to other decolonial feminisms that have been with us.
I wanted to ask you about something that you and Mariana, you and Maria spoke about in an interview in Speaking Face to Face. And she discusses some of the ways in which her mother practiced different forms of art to resist her situation. And just really quickly, I know that art is something that's really important to both you and Maria. And so I wanted to ask you about some of the ways that you think practicing or even just creating different forms of art, whether it be music or painting or drawing or sculpture, whatever the case may be, how that functions as a means for resistance, and and maybe even some of the ways that you found yourself kind of resisting through creation.
That's for me, art is. It's my love. And I think that it's sad when you think about the history of aesthetics, where you have this sustained view that aesthetics is marked by disinterestedness, by lack of politics. We have seen a lot of arguments against that by now. But I think there's a component to art that is not just about the bigger political project, but a deeply personal resistant project. And I'm writing about this right now, actually a paper on the way that doing art allows us to see ourselves otherwise than the colonialist gaze sees us. And I have been very inspired by Gloria Anzaldúa's work on this, except that she uses cuentos, she uses her own writing to forge a new way of being, a new consciousness that allows her to understand that she's not just what the white person or the Mexican male sexist man sees her, right? That she can be otherwise, despite the fact that she is experiencing intimate terrorism from living at the edge of worlds, from seeing life from one side and life from another side, and as somebody who identifies as a woman, as a queer, who identifies as queer, as de las otras, right? As she questioned a lot of the language that we use to describe her sexuality. So as being una de las otras who's caught in the midst of all these different cultures, also including indigenous cultures, she forges her own bones, she says, through her cuentos. And so it seems to me that Ansaldúa is just but one example that shows how creation, artistic creation, in many ways allows for, I think, being otherwise and seeing otherwise and seeing yourself otherwise. And so I deeply believe in the power of creativity. And I don't mean high art. I mean engaging with different material, different paint, whether it be light for photography or paint or wood or words on a page or sound. There are different ways, I think, where we can make worlds in which we thrive, in which we're different than what the colonial gaze assumes that we are. I think there are possibilities too for bigger political projects through art, although I haven't thought about that as much. I think that's a much more difficult question. But for me, I paint, and in paint, I find many parts of myself that I don't find in other parts because they're not seen, because people expect me to be a specific way, right? Because I'm a Latino or because I had specific interest in philosophy that they don't like, maybe because I like metaphysics and maybe they don't, or and so I get to be somebody who is, I wouldn't say different, sometimes the same, sometimes contradicting, some, you know, it depends. But I think something happens in the handling of media when you're creating something artistic that touches you too, and touches your very self. And so I do think that this is also an important way of being an active subject, in a sense, by way of a relationship with elements, material elements that also touch you, and you create things that are also connected to other beings. It's not a lonely process because you are already connected to others. As Ansaldúa says, in terms of border artists, it's an art that's always connected to others. I think in that sense, Lugones's relational account of the I-we is something that can be part of the artistic process.
So I kind of wanted to ask you about how, in facing a lot of the social and political challenges of our current worldly climate, I wanted to ask you if you could speak to some of the obstacles that you think are still keeping us from deep coalition across oppressed groups.
Yes. I think that that is such a hard question. I think Lugones's work is, in my mind, one of the most important views, insofar as it is so deeply committed to coalitions across differences. And hence her development of complex communication and alternative understandings of space and how we come together. And we have many, in a way, it feels as if we just never moved forward, but it seems to me that the current climate, and not just in the US, but in many countries, in Latin America, in Europe, the rise of groups that are extreme to the right, and the rise of leaders that are not interested at all in coalitions, but rather in the re-inscription of difference. And just like we talk about deep coalition, I think we should talk about deep difference that is construed in such a way that there is no possibility of not even sitting at the table, or we can put it even more radically, that there's not even a table at all, or a room where we can all be together. And now talking through our differences and creating space where we will, no. So I think that there is, that's one of the biggest obstacles, that deep difference has been reified. And because it has been reified, it is allowing for the expression of hate towards that difference, whatever that difference, depending on the different contexts, for hate against particular groups of people, for hate against particular thoughts, a particular discipline, science. Right? How can you hate science? But this idea is that it seems to me we are at a moment where I'm very pessimistic about the possibility of coalitions across difference when the differences are so deeply ingrained and have been made even deeper. Now, there's still the question of whether there's coalition across these groups that are themselves working against that kind of movement of people in the right and reactionaries. And I think that I have seen a little bit of move towards people being more willing to talk, even though one side, like Bernie, and they just could not see an established, you know, a candidate from the Democratic establishment, because it would be more of the same, right? I have seen interesting moves in which some people that would never have gotten into even believing in the democratic process and in an election, that they're going to vote. And so I think some people are perhaps seeing that we might have to do some difficult coalitions in order to fight something that is absolutely much bigger and absolutely horrifying if it continues, if there's more hate. And especially for communities of color in this country, for exiles and immigrants in so many other countries, there has been so much movement in the world, right? So many migrations from places of, that are having horrific wars, political systems, migrating to Europe, the rise of the right in Europe because of these migrations. There are so many people right now that are in perilous conditions. And so I think that somehow we need to figure out how to create, if not a coalition, some kind of strategic arrangement.
Yeah.
Right? In order to protect our communities and protect those people who are in perilous conditions.
The more playful we are going into those engagements, and like the more willing we are to be wrong or maybe the person that was inflicting harm, or maybe the person that does need to take accountability or change the way that they're approaching something, would definitely help make reconcile with those difficulties. Because I don't think it cures the difficulties, and I agree that those difficulties are necessary for recognizing the ways in which we are different from one another. Mm-hmm. But I think that a lot of her work is really aiming towards this ability to kind of get past those obstacles.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the issue of playfulness, to be frank, was a difficult one for me. I think because I was a deeply serious person. But once I understood the meaning of playfulness, I think there are various senses of playfulness, and in Lugones' account of playfulness. And one is, as she puts it, being able to be the fool, right? Being able to make mistakes. But also playfulness for her means being able to do things in a different way that they're usually done. And so if you have rules for a game, if you're playing a game, being able to, let's make them up. Let's have some new rules. And so in that sense, I am... I think it's a great way of thinking about how we have to move politically, because in many cases we will have to change the rules of the game, not only the rules of the game that's already the normative rules, but our own sense of how we are supposed to resist. And so resisting itself is an ongoing process. And in that sense, we have to do it playfully. In so far as playfulness means allowing for joy to come in to the process, I think that's I have disagreed with Maria's account insofar as I think that for some immigrants, for some people, sometimes there's no room for that. In the particular situation that they're finding themselves in, there might not be that room. Yeah. But insofar as playfulness is this disruption of normative rules and allowing for, I didn't get it, but let's make something up too, or let's change the game. I think it would allow us for a different way of getting together to do politics that might yield to different ways of protesting, different ways of carrying out acts of civil disobedience, as Dr. King suggested that we do. And so I think it would be interesting to think about how, if we are that flexible, what other ways of being civil, engaging in civil disobedience can we think of?
If there was anything that you feel we didn't touch on for Maria, or there's any last comments that you'd like to make about remembering Maria and her work and her influence in and outside the field, I would like to give you a space to say something, or to maybe readdress something that that you didn't get to finish a thought
thank
on.
You. Well, first I want to thank you for the interview. And I think that to end, I just want to say that we keep reading this book, but in a way, you know, I have read it many times, and there's always something new that I see or that I have missed. And in this sense, I think that I always find myself inspired by Maria's work. And I think it's important to understand the power of her work and how many of the essays in this text were bringing up issues at a time that it was hard to bring up those issues. And she was doing it as a woman of color in US academia. And she was writing in Spanish, writing stories, rethinking the way of how we can do theory. I think in this sense, she was inspired by Anzaldúa, the way Anzaldúa cannot be caught in a disciplinary square. I think the same of Maria. And so I invite people, viewers of the interview, to look at Maria's work in that sense, in the way in which it itself was being playful in terms of philosophical norms, in terms of norms about finding who we are, and also in terms of the way she was trying to connect theoretical views with her own life, but also with our lives as people who are complex, who are multiplicitous, and occupy different social locations, and thus consequently have consciousness that, in my view, are multiplicitous, and sometimes allow for a very respectful and serious engagement with questions of ambiguity, contradiction, and complexity. In that even there's something to learn. And so I really invite all the viewers to take up the text and read them again and again to see what she has to offer. And I think despite of the fact that she's gone from this world, I think she remains in our other various worlds of sense, philosophical worlds, existential worlds, political worlds, given that her work is so expansive.